Thank you for joining Resurrection Lutheran Church this Sunday morning, giving praise with us for God's blessings of music, prayer, and scripture. I, Pastor Karen Perkins, will be sharing a message of grace, forgiveness, and hope. All of the worship leaders welcome you. Please rise as you are able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, God of manna, the God of miracles, and the God of mercy.
Amen.
And now it's time for the children's message. So today's gospel can sometimes be very confusing. In the gospel, you're going to hear, "Very truly, I tell you, unless you eat of the flesh of man and drink his blood, you have no life in you." That's really confusing. But what Jesus is trying to say is, He doesn't want you to necessarily chew on him like you would bread. No. He's not saying that. What Jesus is reminding us is that his teachings are so important that they need to be done daily, just like eating and drinking. That's what's important. He's telling people that God is as important as the bread we eat. So as our bodies grow strong and healthy from food and drink and all the things that we do, our body also grows stronger when we do the Lord's work and live through the Lord on a daily basis. We also then become stronger. So, we eat every day. I hope everybody is able to eat every day. We drink every day. And we should pray every day and ask for enlightenment. Because the stronger our relationship is with God, the stronger we become. So remember, when Jesus says, "Eat of my flesh and drink of my blood," he wants you to also make sure that on a daily basis you include him in your day. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for Jesus, who teaches us how to daily receive your gifts so that we can enjoy them and grow strong in them. Thank you, and amen.
Amen. I invite you to rise as you are able. Let us together welcome the gospel. In John's Gospel, the feeding of the 5,000 leads to extended teaching in which Jesus identifies himself as the true bread of life. Finally, in these verses, he makes a connection that would not be understood until after his death, in light of the church's celebration of Holy Communion. The Holy Gospel, according to St. John, the 6th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, "I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh." The Jews then disputed amongst themselves, saying, "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?" So Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink of his blood, you have no life in you. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. For my flesh is the true food, and my blood is the true drink. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, I live because of the Father. So whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and they died. But the one who eats this bread will live forever." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Live, 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 live. Somebody count out how many times the word live shows up in this passage.
This is the third in a series of passages. They come after the feeding of the 5,000. They cover this section of John that can be quite confusing, and there's overlap each week, and with slightly different emphases. And in this one, we hear the word live a lot. Live. I live in the Father, you live in me. Eat my flesh and live. There's an important historical context to know, though, for this preaching, for this teaching, that might make it a little bit more accessible, is that at the time of Jesus' teaching, and then certainly at the time that the Gospel of John was written, that the emphasis in Greco-Roman philosophy was philosophical and very much understanding, knowledge, gnosis, and thinking about those things which are spiritual as separate. That's where we get this sense of separation of body and spirit. It really comes from Greco-Roman philosophy, is that there's this you know, body, spirit. Sometimes we talk about them as though they're different things. And so for the philosophers of the time, those elements that are spiritual are really important. And then you also have the writings of Paul that in some way, not in some ways, sometimes very directly, disparage the flesh and living in the flesh. And so here we have something that's talking about the importance of eating the flesh and the fleshliness of Jesus. Well, that would contrast from the Greco-Roman philosophy, saying, wait a minute, being in this physicalness, being in this eating this thing together, eating that which I give you is important, and it's a physical act. It's a physical act at communion. Now, for the Jews, with kosher laws, the idea of eating blood of anything with that, I mean, animal is what they're talking about in you know, the law, but is abhorrent. I mean, that's just abhorrent. The blood is drained as part of the preparation, kosher preparation of meat. The blood is drained. And so this drinking of blood is just, I mean, it's just revolting to them. It's probably revolting to many of us. I just happen to be listening to a series on a vampire series that Clarice got me started on. So anyway, there's the whole drinking the blood abhorrent thing in it. That's what you get in vampire novels. But the contrast there is that for the Greeks, who by the time we're talking to John's community, they're really separating the Jews from the Christians. And the Christians are being persecuted by the government, the Gentiles. So the philosophers want to talk about that which is spiritual and that which is knowledge. And the Jews, who are willing to talk about those things that are physical, because physical sacrifice and a lot of the ritual involves physicality. This drinking of the blood is disgusting, and it's kind of pushing on both of those groups to say, my picture is bigger than this. It is bigger than your philosophy that deals with the spiritual and knowledge, and it is bigger than the rituals and the rites and the rules of observance. That in this gift that God has given, I have become flesh, and I am sacrificing my flesh for you. And somehow it will be present at that meal when you share it. And then there's a big emphasis on wisdom to try to tie it back into, well, what are those things that are spiritual, and what are those things that are knowledge, and what are those the rituals about? Well, there's a lot about wisdom. And so we get the from Proverbs about wisdom. And we get Paul talking about wisdom. And the interesting thing about the way eating the flesh is talked about in this passage is the word here for eat, and it was funny that you said not to chew on, the word here for is used for eat, there are different words for eat, is really kind of chew on or masticate or you know, what are the other words that we use for the actual, you know, grinding up of food in our mouths and digesting it? It's not a nice clean eat, and there are words for it, eat word. It's a chew on my body. Chew on it. So when we receive the Eucharist, we're invited always to chew on the meaning of that, to really gnaw, that was the word I was looking for, gnaw on it. What is this? What is this for me? What is this doing in me? What is this beyond me? What is this? And similarly, when we chew on the word of God, because remember in John, the word came down, the word became flesh, the word was flesh, the word was the light of the world, and that's Jesus. So we are chewing on the word of Scripture. It's the chewing on it that gives us wisdom. Hearing it is certainly a good thing, and one of the reasons I always include all the readings is that sometimes what I preach may you know, the Spirit may do something with that in you, but sometimes the other readings may be the ones that wash over you and do something. And so there are these gifts of Scripture that we're given and invited to chew on to become wise. Not wise in the ways of the world, but wise in the ways of God. And it is very service-oriented. It's very much community-oriented. Chew on this with other people. It's why often you'll find in Lutheran Bible studies they're conversational. Because you got to chew on it together. Kind of hear what people are hearing and understanding, and listen to their perspective and listen to how their life stories influence the way they hear. And for you to be able to talk about your life experiences and the way your life experiences allow you to hear, and trying to understand together, okay, what is God saying in that as we are together, as we chew on it together. So chew on it with people who are less like you than more like you, because you'll get a wider breadth of this wisdom, which is also, wisdom is given this feminine role in the Old Testament. There's debate as to whether or not that's just because the word wisdom is a feminine word, or in grammatically, or wisdom is really evocative of the feminine in the Trinity. But the sense of how do we live into the wholeness of this at this moment? Because like Karen said, you eat every day. Even if I have the best meal today, the best, everything I want, plenty of it, plenty of rapport with wonderful people that I'm eating with, or very different people with whom I'm eating, I still need to eat tomorrow. Because tomorrow I'm a different person who needs to be nourished again. And then the next day I'm a different person who needs to be nourished again. So one of the reasons that we have returned in the ELCA, at any rate, to the communion every week from some patterns that had gotten more common. But, and for Luther, it was really this commune whenever you're given the opportunity. Because you're given this real presence, and that it is the mystery of communion. We're not exactly sure. We say in with and under, the Lutheran phrase, in with and under. Not sure exactly how it happens, but this real Jesus presence, this real physical thing, there has to be something physical attached to our sacraments so that we can touch them, so they can become part of us. Because that's what happens as you digest, right? Food doesn't just pass through you. The nutrients are taken out and become part of yourselves, part of your body, part of who you are. They live in you. And that same bread becomes part of the body of your neighbor. And your other neighbor, and your other neighbor. It's a uniting function. I'll talk more about unity next week. But there's this really digesting piece that is important to appreciate. I often talk about the Gospel of Matthew being the most visceral, but here there's this really being in life, being in God, life being in Jesus, being in one another. Well, how are we in one another? It also opened up Christians to the accusation of cannibalism, for which they were also persecuted. And yes, there were, because often infants were baptized, there was this, reputation of drowning our infants and then practicing cannibalism, which was an accusation that happened and, got many people executed. But it's not that it's about what we associate with cannibalism as this aggressive, victory power substance act. But as this offering act that Jesus is saying, I'm giving you something not just while I'm with you, not just with the Spirit who is always with you, but in this that you can have every day, the Word, the sacrament, this piece of me that every time you digest it will be different for you. Because every time you digest it, grace is present in it, but you've changed. That's how we grow. That's how we grow in the wisdom that we understand and in our ability to listen. Because it's a very humble act to receive communion. It's why people who are able to comfortably kneel often kneel and put out our hands. It's a show of humility to say, really, I'm willing to accept what you have to offer, God. I trust that this thing that you have to offer is of sacred value. Let us receive it in that spirit. Let our wisdom be driven always by that spirit. Let our wisdom be driven by what we learn in and through Jesus, so that we might, what was the word that I said showed up a lot? Live. So that we might live the life that we're called to. Live the life that is led by Jesus. Live the life that we will be, and in many ways are being resurrected into, that Jesus has been resurrected into, so that we might live according to God's wisdom. So I invite you this week, Chew on God daily. Chew on the Lord at the table. Let it become part of you and us. But then remember to keep eating, to keep being nourished. Too bad we don't have or maybe you do have a spiritual grumbling in your tummy, or wherever you would have your spiritual grumbling. But when you have that grumbling that says, I'm hungry, God, for the word. You have resources, you have it available to you. May it be so for each of us today and throughout our lives. Amen.
Calling on the Spirit of wisdom to guide our hearts and our minds, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Wisdom has built her house. May the church be a house of wisdom for all who enter. May we continue to grow and stretch in ways we never thought possible. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Wisdom has mixed her wine. May the harvest seasons be plentiful this year. We pray for orchards, vineyards, farms, hatcheries, and all creation. Protect and conserve the earth. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Wisdom has employed her laborers. Be with all who seek adequate employment. Guide our economic and governmental leaders to support the people of our world with fair wages and safe working conditions. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Wisdom has invited her guests. Make your presence known to all who feel lost, abandoned, or hurting at this time. Direct your spirit of care to all who seek healing and comfort. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Wisdom has set her table. May this congregation be a welcome table to all who seek the refuge of God. Break down walls and barriers that prevent us from offering a seat at this table to anyone who comes. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Wisdom has shown her path of insight. May we journey on her paths, looking toward a bright future while remembering from where we have come. We give thanks to those who have gone before us. Merciful God, receive our prayer. We lift up these prayers to you, gracious God. Receive them into your holy keeping. Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The blessing of God, who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever. Amen.
Go in peace. You are the body of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
This has been an abridged worship service of Resurrection Lutheran Church. You are welcome to join us for worship in person on Sunday mornings at 9:30. We are located at 740 West 10th Street in downtown Juneau. Our phone number is 586-2380. More information about our location, parking lot, current COVID policy, and other contact information is available on our website at rlcjuneau.org. The website is also the best way to learn about what events are happening with the community outreach ministry, Juneau Live. With a vital food pantry, bell choir, quilting group, Bible study, and others, there may be a ministry here just for you. Come and see.